Book 16. Telemachus dispatches Eumaeus to the city to inform Penelope of his safe return from Pylos. During his absence, Ulysses makes himself known to his son. The suitors, having watched for Telemachus in vain, arrive again at Ithaca. It was the hour of dawn when in the cot kindling fresh fire, Ulysses and his friend noble Eumaeus dressed their morning fare and sent the herdsman with the swine abroad. Seeing Telemachus, the watchful dogs barked not, but fawned around him. At that sight, and at the sound of feet which now approached, Ulysses, in winged accents, thus remarked, "Eumaeus, certain either friend of thine is nigh at hand, or one whom well thou knowest. Thy dogs bark not, but fawn on his approach obsequious, and the sound of feet I hear." Scarce had he ceased, when his own son himself stood in the vestibule. Up sprang at once Eumaeus wonderstruck, and from his hand let fall the cups with which he was employed mingling rich wine. To his young lord he ran, his forehead kissed his bright beaming eyes and both his hands, weeping profuse the while, as when a father folds in his embrace, arrived from foreign lands in the 10th year, his darling son, the offspring of his age, his only one, for whom he long hath mourned. So kissed the noble peasant o'er and o'er godlike Telemachus, as from death escaped, and in winged accents plaintive thus began, "Light of my eyes, thou comest, it is thyself, sweetest Telemachus. I had no hope to see thee more, once told that o'er the deep thou hadst departed for the Pylian coast. Enter, my precious son, that I may soothe my soul with sight of thee from far arrived, for seldom thou thy feeders and thy farm visitest, in the city customed much to make abode, that thou mayst witness there the manners of those hungry suitors proud." To whom Telemachus discreet replied, "It will be so, there is great need, my friend, but here for thy sake have I now arrived, that I may look on thee and from thy lips learn if my mother still reside at home, or have become spouse of some other chief, leaving untenanted Ulysses' bed to be by noisome spiders webbed around." To whom the master swineherd in return, "Not so, she, patient still as ever, dwells beneath thy roof, but all her cheerless days despairing wastes, and all her nights in tears." So saying, Eumaeus at his hand received his brazen lance, and o'er the step of stone entered Telemachus, to whom his sire relinquished, soon as he appeared, his seat. But him Telemachus forbidding said, "Guest, keep thy seat, our cottage will afford some other, which Eumaeus will provide." He ceased, and he, returning at the word, reposed again. Then good Eumaeus spread green twigs beneath, which, covered with a fleece, supplied Ulysses' offspring with a seat. He next disposed his dishes on the board with relics charged of yesterday. With bread, alert, he heaped the baskets, with rich wine his ivy cup replenished, and a seat took opposite to his illustrious lord Ulysses. They, toward the plenteous feast, stretched forth their hands, and hunger now and thirst both satisfied, Telemachus, his speech addressing to their generous host, began, "Whence is this guest, my father? How conveyed came he to Ithaca? What country boast the mariners with whom he here arrived? For that on foot he found us not is sure." To whom, Eumaeus, thou didst thus reply, "I will with truth answer thee, O my son. He boasts him sprung from ancestry renowned in spacious Crete, and hath the cities seen of various lands by fate ordained to Rome. Even now, from a Thesprotian trip escaped, he reached my cottage, but he is thy own. I yield him to thee. Treat him as thou wilt. He is thy suppliant and depends on thee." Then thus Telemachus discreet replied, "Thy words, Eumaeus, pain my very soul, for what security can I afford to any in my house? Myself am young, nor yet of strength sufficient to repel an offered insult, and my mother's mind in doubtful balance hangs. If still with me an inmate, she shall manage my concerns, attentive only to her absent lord, and her own good report, or shall espouse the noblest of her wooers, and the best entitled by the splendour of his gifts. But I will give him, since I find him lodged a guest beneath thy roof, tunic and cloak, sword double-edged and sandals for his feet, with convoy to the country of his choice. Still, if it please thee, keep him here thy guest, and I will send him raiment, with supplies of all sorts, lest he burthen thee and thine. But where the suitors come, there shall not he with my consent, nor stand exposed to pride and petulance like theirs, lest by some sneer they wound him, and through him wound also me. For little is it that the boldest can against so many, numbers will prevail. Him answered then Ulysses toil inured, O amiable and good, since even I am free to answer thee, I will avow my heart within me torn by what I hear of those injurious suitors, who the house infest of one noble as thou appearest. But say, submittest thou to their control willingly, or because the people, swayed by some response oracular, incline against thee? Thou hast brothers, it may chance, slow to assist thee, for a brother's aid is of importance in whatever cause. For oh, that I had youth as I have will, or that renowned Ulysses were my sire, or that himself might wander home again, whereof hope yet remains. Then might I lose my head that moment by an alien's hand, if I would fail entering Ulysses' gate, to be the bane and mischief of them all. But if alone to multitudes opposed I should perchance be foiled, nobler it were with my own people under my own roof to perish than to witness evermore their unexampled deeds, guests shoved aside, maidens dragged forcibly from room to room, casks emptied of their rich contents, and them indulging gluttonous appetite day by day enormous, without measure, without end. To whom Telemachus discreet replied, Stranger, thy question shall from me receive true answer. Enmity or hatred none subsists the people and myself between, nor have I brothers to accuse, whose aid is of importance in whatever cause. For Jove hath from old with single heirs our house supplied. Arceisius none begat except Laertes, and Laertes none except Ulysses, and Ulysses me left here his only one, and unenjoyed. Thence comes it that our palace swarms with foes, for all the rulers of the neighbour isles, Samos, Dulichium, and the forest-crowned Zacynthus, others also rulers here in craggy Ithaca, my mother seek in marriage, and my household stores consume. But neither she those nuptial rites abhorred, refuses absolute, nor yet consents to end them. They my patrimony waste meantime, and will destroy me also soon, as I expect. But heaven disposes all. Eumaeus, haste, my father, bear with speed news to Penelope that I am safe, and have arrived from Pylos. I will wait till thou return, and well beware that none hear thee beside, for I have many foes. To whom, Eumaeus, thou didst thus reply, It is enough, I understand, thou speak'st to one intelligent. But say beside, shall I not also, as I go, inform distressed Laertes, who while yet he mourned Ulysses only could o'ersee the works, and dieted among his menials oft as hunger prompted him, but now, they say, since thy departure to the Pylian shore, he neither eats as he was wont, nor drinks, nor oversees his hinds, but sighing sits and weeping, wasted even to the bone. Him then Telemachus answered discreet, Hard though it be, yet to his tears and sighs him leave we now, we cannot what we would. For, were the ordering of all events referred to our own choice, our first desire should be to see my father's glad return. But once thy tidings told, wander not thou in quest of him, but hither speed again. Rather request my mother that she send her household's governess without delay privately to him. She shall best inform the ancient king that I have safe arrived. He said, and urged him forth, who, binding on his sandals, to the city bent his way. Nor went Eumaeus from his home unmarked by Pallas, who, in semblance of a fair damsel, accomplished in domestic arts, approaching to the cottage entrance, stood opposite, by Ulysses plain discerned, but to his son invisible, for the gods appear not manifest alike to all. The mastiff saw her also, and with tone querulous hid themselves, yet barked they not. She beckoned him abroad. Ulysses saw the sign, and issuing through the outer court approached her, whom the goddess thus bespake. Laertes' progeny, for wiles renowned, disclose thyself to thy own son, that, death concerting and destruction to your foes, ye may the royal city seek, nor long shall ye my presence there desire in vain, for I am ardent to begin the fight. Minerva spake, and with her rod of gold touched him. His mantle first and vest she made pure as new blanched. Dilating next his form, she gave dimensions ampler to his limbs. Swarthy again his manly hue became, round his full face, and black his bushy chin. The change performed, Minerva disappeared, and the illustrious hero turned again into the cottage. Wonder at that sight seized on Telemachus. Askance he looked, awe-struck, not unsuspicious of a god, and in winged accents eager thus began. Thou art no longer whom I lately saw, nor are thy clothes, nor is thy port the same. Thou art a god, I know, and dwell'st in heaven. O smile on us, that we may yield thee rites acceptable, and present thee golden gifts elaborate. Ah, spare us, power divine! To whom Ulysses, hero, toil inured. I am no god. Why deem'st thou me divine? I am thy father, for whose sake thou lead'st a life of woe by violence oppressed. So saying, he kissed his son, while from his cheeks tears trickled, tears till then perforce restrained. Telemachus, for he believed him not his father yet, thus wondering spake again. My father, saidst thou? No, thou art not he, but some divinity beguiles my soul with mockeries to afflict me still the more, for never mortal man could have so wrought by his own power. Some interposing god alone could render thee both young and old, for old thou wast of late, and foully clad, but wear'st the semblance now of those in heaven. To whom Ulysses ever wise replied, Telemachus, it is not well, my son, that thou shouldst greet thy father with a face of wild astonishment and stand aghast. Ulysses, save myself, none comes, be sure. Such as thou seest, after 10,000 woes which I have borne, I visit once again my native country in the 20th year. This wonder Athenian Pallas wrought, she clothed me even with what form she would, for so she can. Now poor I seem, and old, now young again, and clad in fresh attire. The gods who dwell in yonder heaven with ease dignify or debase a mortal man. So saying, he sat, then threw Telemachus his arms around his father's neck and wept. Desire intense of lamentation seized on both, soft murmurs uttering, each indulged his grief, more frequent wailing than the bird, eagle or hook-nailed vulture, from whose nest some swain hath stolen her yet unfeathered young. So from their eyelids they big drops distilled of tenderest grief, nor had the setting sun cessation of their weeping seen, had not Telemachus his father thus addressed. What ship conveyed thee to thy native shore, my father, and what country boast the crew? For that on foot thou not arrived'st is sure. Then thus divine Ulysses toil inured. My son, I will explicit all relate. Conducted by Phaeacia's maritime sons I came, a race accustomed to convey strangers who visit them across the deep. Me o'er the billows in a rapid bark, borne sleeping, on the shores of Ithaca they laid. Rich gifts they gave me also, brass, gold in full bags, and beautiful attire, which, warned from heaven, I have in caves concealed. By Pallas prompted, hither I repaired, that we might plan the slaughter of our foes, whose number tell me now, that I may know how powerful, certainly, and who they are, and consultation with my dauntless heart may hold, if we be able to contend ourselves with all, or must have aid beside. Then answer thus his son discreet returned, My father, thy renown hath ever rung in thy son's ears, and by report thy force in arms and wisdom I have oft been told. But terribly thou speak'st, amazement fixed I hear, can to a multitude oppose, and valiant warriors all? For neither 10 are they, nor 20, but more numerous far. Learn now their numbers. 50 youths and 2 came from Dulichium. They are chosen men, and 6 attendants follow in their train. From Samos 20 youths and 4 arrive, Zacynthus also of Achaea's sons sends 20 more, and our own island adds herself her 12 chief rulers, Medon, too, is there the herald and the bard divine, with other two intendants of the board. Should we within the palace, we alone assail them all, I fear lest thy revenge unpleasant to thyself and deadly prove, frustrating thy return. But recollect, think, if thou canst, on whose confederate arm strenuous on our behalf we may rely. To him replied his patient father bold, I will inform thee, mark, weigh well my words. Will Pallas and the everlasting sire alone suffice, or need we other aids? Then answer thus Telemachus returned, Good friends indeed are they whom thou hast named, though throned above the clouds, for their control is universal both in earth and heaven. To whom Ulysses, toil-worn chief renowned, Not long will they from battle stand aloof, when once within my palace in the strength of Mars, to sharp decision we shall urge the suitors. But thyself at early dawn our mansion seek, that thou mayst mingle there with that imperious throng. Me, in due time, Eumaeus to the city shall conduct, in form a miserable beggar old. But should they with dishonourable scorn insult me, thou unmoved my wrongs endure. And should they even drag me by the feet abroad, or smite me with the spear, thy wrath refraining, gentle counsel them to cease from such extravagance. But well I know that cease they will not, for their hour is come. And mark me well, treasure what now I say deep in thy soul. When Pallas shall herself suggest the measure, then, shaking my brows, I will admonish thee, thou, at the sign, remove what arms soever in the hall remain, and in the upper palace safe dispose them. Should the suitors, missing them, perchance interrogate thee, then reply gently, I have removed them from the smoke. For they appear no more the arms which erst Ulysses, going hence to Ilium, left, but smirched and sullied by the breath of fire. This weightier reason thou shalt also say, Jove taught me, lest, intoxicate with wine, ye should assault each other in your brawls, shaming both feast and courtship, for the view itself of arms incites to their abuse. Yet leave two falchions for ourselves alone, two spears, two bucklers, which with sudden force impetuous we will seize, and Jove all-wise their valour shall and Pallas steal away. This word store also in remembrance deep. If mine in truth thou art and of my blood, then of Ulysses to his home returned. Let none hear news from thee, no, not my sire Laertes, nor Eumaeus, nor of all the menials any, or even Penelope, that thou and I alone may search the drift of our domestic women, and may prove our serving men, who honours and reveres, and who contemns us both, but chiefly thee, so gracious and so worthy to be loved. Him then thus answered his illustrious son, Trust me, my father, thou shalt soon be taught that I am not of drowsy mind obtuse, but this I think not likely to avail or thee or me. Ponder it yet again. For tedious were the task, farm after farm to visit of those servants proving each, and the proud suitors merciless devour meantime thy substance, nor abstain from aught. Learn if thou wilt, and I that course myself advise, who slights thee of the female train, and who is guiltless. But I would not try from house to house the men, far better proved hereafter, if in truth by signs from heaven informed, thou hast been taught the will of Jove. Thus they conferred. The gallant bark meantime reached Ithaca, from which the Pylian shore had brought Telemachus with all his band. Within the many-fathomed port arrived, his lusty followers hailed her far aground, then carried thence their arms, but to the house of Clytius the illustrious gifts conveyed. Next to the royal mansion they dispatched a herald charged with tidings to the queen, that her Telemachus had reached the cot of good Eumaeus, and the bark had sent home to the city, lest the matchless dame should still deplore the absence of her son. They then, the herald and the swineherd, each bearing like message to his mistress, met, and at the palace of the godlike chief arriving, compassed by the female throng inquisitive, the herald thus began, Thy son, O queen, is safe, even now returned. Then, drawing nigh to her, Eumaeus told his message also from her son received, and, his commission punctually discharged, leaving the palace, sought his home again. Grief seized and anguish at those tidings all the suitors, issuing forth on the outside of the high wall they sat before the gate, when Polybus' son Eurymachus began, "My friends, his arduous task, this voyage deemed by us impossible, in our despite Telemachus hath achieved. Haste, launch we forth a sable bark, our best, which let us man with mariners expert, who, rowing forth swiftly, shall summon our companions home." Scarce had he said, when turning where he sat, Amphinomus beheld a bark arrive just then in port. He saw them furling sail, and seated with their oars in hand, he laughed through pleasure at that sight, and thus he spake, "Our message may be spared. Lo, they arrive. Either some god informed them, or they saw themselves the vessel of Telemachus too swiftly passing to be reached by theirs." He spake, they, rising, hasted to the shore. Alert they drew the sable bark aground, and by his servant each his arms dispatched to his own home. Then all, to counsel those assembling, neither elder of the land nor youth allowed to join them, and the rest Eupithes' son, Antinous, thus bespake, "Ah, how the gods have rescued him! All day perched on the airy mountain top our spies successive watched, and when the sun declined we never slept on shore, but all night long till sacred dawn arose, ploughed the abyss, hoping Telemachus that we might seize and slay him, whom some deity hath led in our despite safe to his home again. But frame we yet again means to destroy Telemachus. Ah, let not him escape. For end of this our task, while he survives, none shall be found, such prudence he displays and wisdom, neither are the people now unanimous our friends as heretofore. Come then, prevent him, ere he call the Greeks to counsel, for he will not long delay, and will be angry doubtless, and will tell amid them all how we in vain devised his death, a deed which they will scarce applaud, but will perhaps punish and drive us forth from our own country to a distant land. Prevent him, therefore, quickly in the field, slay him, or on the road so shall his wealth and his possessions on ourselves devolve, which we will share equally, but his house shall be the queen's, and his whom she shall wed. Yet, if not so inclined, ye rather choose that he should live and occupy entire his patrimony, then, no longer here assembled, let us revel at his cost, but let us all with spousal gifts produced from our respective treasures woo the queen, leaving her in full freedom to espouse who proffers most and whom the fates ordain." He ceased. The assembly silent sat and mute. Then rose Amphinomus amid them all, offspring renowned of Nisus, son himself of King Aretius. He had thither led the suitor train, who from the pleasant isle corn-clad of green Dulichium had arrived, and by his speech pleased far beyond them all Penelope, for he was just and wise, and thus, well counselling the rest, began. "Not I, my friends, far be the thought from me to slay Telemachus. It were a deed momentous, terrible to slay a prince. First, therefore, let us counsel ask of heaven, and if Jove's oracle that course approve, I will encourage you, and will myself be active in his death. But if the gods forbid it, then by my advice forbear." So spake Amphinomus, whom all approved. Arising then into Ulysses' house they went, where each his splendid seat resumed. A novel purpose occupied meantime Penelope. She purposed to appear before her suitors, whose design to slay Telemachus she had from Medon learned. The herald for his ear had caught the sound. Toward the hall with her attendant train she moved, and when, most graceful of her sex, where sat the suitors she arrived, between the columns standing of the stately dome, and covering with her white veil's lucid folds her features, to Antinous thus she spake. "Antinous, proud, contentious, evermore to mischief prone, the people deem thee wise past thy compeers, and in all grace of speech preeminent, but such wast never thou. Inhuman, why is it thy dark design to slay Telemachus? And why with scorn rejectest thou the suppliant's prayer, which Jove himself hath witnessed? Plots please not the gods. Know'st not that thy own father refuge found here, when he fled before the people's wrath, whom he had irritated by a wrong which, with a band of Taphian robbers joined, he offered to the Thresbots, our allies? They would have torn his heart, and would have laid all his delights and his possessions waste. But my Ulysses slaked the furious heat of their revenge, whom thou requitest now wasting his goods, soliciting his wife, slaying his son, and filling me with woe. But cease, I charge thee, and bid cease the rest. To whom the son of Polybus replied, Eurymachus, Icarius' daughter, wise, take courage, fair Penelope, and chase these fears unreasonable from thy mind. The man lives not, nor shall, who while I live, and faculty of sight retain, shall harm Telemachus thy son. For thus I say, and thus will I perform, his blood shall stream a sable current from my lance's point that moment. For the city-waster chief Ulysses, oft me placing on his knees, hath filled my infant grasp with savoury food, and given me ruddy wine. I therefore hold Telemachus of all men most my friend, nor hath he death to fear from hand of ours. Yet if the gods shall doom him, die he must. So he encouraged her, who yet himself plotted his death. She, reascending, sought her stately chamber, and, arriving there, deplored with tears her long-regretted lord, till Athenian Pallas azure-eyed dews of soft slumber o'er her lids diffused. And now, at eventide, Eumaeus reached Ulysses and his son. A yearling swine just slain they skilfully for food prepared, when Pallas, drawing nigh, smote with her wand Ulysses, at the stroke rendering him old, and his apparel sordid as before. Lest, knowing him, the swain at once should seek Penelope and let the secret forth. Then foremost him Telemachus addressed, Noble Eumaeus, thou art come. What news bring'st from the city? Have the warrior band of suitors, hopeless of their ambush, reached the port again, or wait they still for me? To whom, Eumaeus, thou didst thus reply, No time for such inquiry, nor to range curious the streets had I, but anxious wish to make my message known, and to return. But, as it chanced, a nimble herald sent from thy companions met me on the way, who reached thy mother first. Yet this I know, for this I saw. Passing above the town where they have piled a wayside hill of stones to Mercury, I beheld a gallant bark entering the port. A bark she was of ours. The crew were numerous, and I marked her deep laden with shields and spears of double edge. Theirs I conjectured her, and could no more. He spake, and by Eumaeus unperceived, Telemachus his father eyed and smiled. Their task accomplished, and the table spread, they ate, nor any his due portion missed, and hunger now and thirst both sated, all to rest repaired, and took the gift of sleep.